When you're doing research, you're always working with numbers or categories, those kinds of things. And those things are called variables. So variables are things that take on more than one value. For example, biological sex is a variable because it has more than one value. A value is the options, the different numbers or categories for a variable. And these are all like within a specific data set. So for example, for biological sex, you might have male, female, and perhaps other, something like that. And then when you're collecting your data and you're measuring each person or whatever it is that you're observing, each individual will have their own value, and the individual's value is called their score. Each person or observation's value. So for example, for me, my biological sex is male, so my score is male. Sometimes when you're doing research, with your data set, with your study, you decide to only include certain kinds of people to simplify the data analysis or the kinds of conclusions that you can draw. And so sometimes something that could be a variable becomes a constant. So a constant is something that could vary in a data set but doesn't. That could vary, could take on multiple values. So for example, if I'm doing a research study and I only recruit males to my study, then biological sex in that scenario is a constant. So notice that biological sex can be a variable or a constant in a particular data set depending on how the researcher does things. If biological sex varies, if the individuals in it take on more than one value, then it's a variable. If everybody has the same value, if they all have the same score, if they're all male, then it's a constant. If they're all female, then it would be a constant. Another example of a variable would be age. The values for that, if you just ask people how many years old are you, right, then you get some 1, 2, 3, 4, and so on. With the person's score, if you asked me, I would be 46 years old at this point in time. However, if you do a study where you only have people who are 46 years old, in that scenario, in that particular study, age is a constant and everybody is 46 years old. I want you to be careful because there's a common mistake that students make while they're learning about variables. And the common mistake is to say that the values are the variables. They'll say male and female are two variables. But really, these are two values for one variable, and that variable is biological sex. Or they'll say the variable is 2 years old, but the variable, again, is not the values or the scores. The variable is the thing that varies across the people, age, or biological sex, or height. happiness, if you're measuring happiness, whatever it is that varies across those folks. It's not just particular values that those people take on, it's the thing that varies across the people that counts as the variable. When you're doing research, variables have other important characteristics or considerations. And the next one I'm going to talk about relates to the kind of research that you're doing. So scientific research can be broken down into two types. There are experiments and correlational studies. And let's say we're doing a research study and we want to find out if drinking caffeine increases alertness or decreases tiredness. In that case, the researcher thinks that caffeine has a causal effect. It influences alertness or it influences tiredness by reducing tiredness. So in that case, the causal variable is caffeine. And if a researcher wants to find out if caffeine decreases tiredness, they could do an experiment or they could do a correlational study. If they do an experiment, that causal variable is manipulated. Manipulated variables, the manipulated is a strange term, so a little non-intuitive, I think. A manipulated variable is one in which the researcher assigns the participants to different experiences or different values of that independent variable. So here, we could have participants come in and we could give them caffeinated coffee or decaffeinated coffee. And the caffeinated value, the people that have that, would have caffeine, and those in the decaf condition wouldn't have any caffeine. In an experiment, you would manipulate the causal variable, caffeine for example, and then you would measure the outcome, ask people how tired they are, maybe give them 10 minutes or something like that for the coffee to kick in. In a correlational study, you don't manipulate the causal variable. You measure it. You might ask people how many cups of caffeinated coffee they've had already today, and then you would also measure whatever the effect variable is, the outcome variable. You'd ask them how tired they are. And so researchers do experiments or correlational studies for different reasons, right? So experiments are great because they let the researcher infer causality. They let you know if whatever you manipulated affected whatever the outcome variable was. And they do that because you control for other variables. By having participants show up into your lab and then you flip a coin, if they get heads, you give them caffeinated coffee, you give them tails, they get decaffeinated coffee. On average, the participants in those two groups will be the same as each other on all the different ways that they vary. So you're controlling for those different characteristics in that way. And then the only difference, if you have large enough sample sizes, the only difference on average across those two groups will be whether they have the caffeinated coffee or the decaffeinated coffee. So that's a really nice thing about experiments, and that's why they're a great way to infer causality. Correlational studies, because you're not controlling for those other variables, a lot of things could differ, depending, you know, that could lead somebody to drink more coffee, but also be less tired. Let's say if you're up really late the night before, that might make you drink more coffee, but also be more tired. So it's a variable, a third variable that could influence both. I'll call them these third variables are problems. They're alternative explanations for the correlation between your cause and your effect. Generally, though, these are a little bit easier to do. So that makes correlational studies nice. And another nice thing about correlational studies is if there is a relationship overall between caffeine and tiredness, hopefully when you go out and measure people in the world, you measure how much caffeine they've drank and how tired they are. Generally, across all these different situations, you'd hope you'd find that relationship there. And if you do, that's great because you've demonstrated that it happens out in the real world. And these correlational studies are nice because they let you find out if the relationship you expect exists in the real world. So these are more real world data, whereas these experiments tend to be more like in the lab, and they're often artificial situations where the only thing that differs for your participants is whatever you're manipulating. So we'll go through an example with these. So if we have our participants show up in our lab and we randomly assign them to drink either decaffeinated coffee or caffeinated coffee, we let them hang out for a specific amount of time. We'd want to hold that constant across our participants, and so everybody has the same amount of time there for the caffeine to become activated. And then we measure their tiredness, and we'd want to use the same measure for both. And we'll just say we use a self-report scale where we ask them on a 1 to 10 scale, with 1 being not at all tired and 10 being extremely tired, how tired are you? Right? And what we'd expect with this experiment is people that drank the caffeine would be less tired than those who drank the decaf, if our hypothesis is correct, the way we think the world works. With a correlational study, we might have our participants come in the lab, and then we would first ask them how many cups of coffee did they drink? Or more generally, how many cups of caffeinated beverage or something like that. Right? And then we would ask them how tired they are. And we could use the same self-report measure we used here. And in this case, we would expect people that drank more caffeinated beverages to be less tired, just like we would here. But with this kind of research setup, you won't be able to tell if it's actually the caffeine that's affecting tiredness or if there's other things in those people's lives that are doing it. So these manipulated variables that occur only in experiments, and they actually are how you know if an experiment happened, is people have to be randomly assigned to these experiences, like drinking caffeinated or decaffeinated coffee. So these experiments have special terms for these variables. In an experiment, the manipulated variable is called an independent variable, and the measured outcome variable is called the dependent variable. For short, the independent variable is often called the IV, and the dependent variable is often called the DV. And the idea here is the dependent variable, tiredness, should depend on the manipulated independent variable, whether you had decaf or caffeinated coffee or caffeinated beverage. So this is a really important distinction in research, experiments versus correlational studies. And with experiments, you have the special language even to describe the variables in your study. So I want to do a quick recap of the content of this video on variables. Right, so variables are something that varies across the observations in a data set. Values are the different numbers or categories across any particular variable. And the scores are each person or each observation's values on that variable. So remember, like, height could be a variable in a data set. And people could be 5'7", 5'8", 5'9". And my score would be 5'7", right? Constants are something that could be a variable, but in a particular research study, everybody has the same score, the same value. So in that study, it doesn't vary. So it's not a variable, it's a constant. And then I talked about how there's experiments and correlational studies, and how in experiments, that's a really good kind of research for making causal inferences, and how in that kind of research design, The manipulated variable, where people are assigned different experiences, that's called the independent variable. And that's the causal variable. It's going to be what's causing an effect in the dependent variable or the outcome variable. And remember, this is the language for experiments rather than correlational studies. And it's the presence of a manipulated independent variable that tells you that what you have is an experiment rather than a correlational study where both the causal variable and the outcome variable are measured in a correlational study.